So we're going to go ahead and get started. Everybody ready? Good. All right. My name is Martha. I'm one of the planning committee members and affectionately known as Martha from Maine, and I am from Maine, and I have the distinguished honor to introduce our next two speakers, Patricia Dykes and Dr. Sarah Collins. And so Dr. Dykes is an assistant professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School and Brigham and Women's Hospital Division of Internal Medicine and Primary Care. She holds a PhD in nursing informatics from Columbia University School of Nursing. She's also the research program director for the Center of Patient Safety, Research and Practice at the Brigham and Women's Hospital. Her interests are in leveraging technology to promote quality and safety of care and adverse event prevention. Dr. Dykes and her team have developed a decision support and communication intervention for use by the care team, patients, and family members to prevent patient falls. In addition, she has conducted research on the bedside data needs and preferences of hospitalized patients and is evaluating the use of technology for patient engagement in their plan of care and adverse event prevention. Additionally, Dr. Dykes was the recipient of NENIC's inaugural Rita D. Zellstorf Nursing Informatics Leadership Award. Dr. Collins is a nurse and clinical informatician in clinical informatics at Partners eCare. She's also an instructor in medicine at Harvard Medical School and Brigham and Women's Hospital Division of Internal Medicine and Primary Care. She holds a PhD in nursing informatics from Columbia University School of Nursing, and her research, as well as her applied clinical informatics work, focuses on modeling, developing, and evaluating standards-based, patient-centered, collaborative informatics tools to further patient safety, knowledge development, clinical decision support, and coordinated patient-centered care. Please let us welcome our next two speakers.
Great. Thank you so much for having us this morning. And we really enjoyed doing this last year too. And it's a really fun presentation. Hopefully you all get a chance to kind of hear about some literature you may not have read about, that hopefully some of it can be a bit of a teaser to go find those articles too and read them. But we're gonna review some highlighted articles, and then at the end we'll have a reference list too so that you can see all of them. So neither Patty nor I have any real or apparent conflicts of interest to report. So the objectives today are to review the purpose, objectives, and search strategies and associated limitations of the search that we did. We're going to review the nursing informatics research topics, methods, and findings in the particular journals from which they came, highlight gaps in nursing informatics research, and discuss opportunities for translating informatics evidence into clinical practice. So we surveyed the published literature in the area of nursing informatics using the following criteria of research. So they had to be systematic reviews, randomized control trials, observational and qualitative research, or case studies that had to do with nursing informatics and were published in peer-reviewed journals between March 1st 2014 and February 28th, 2015. And so this, you know, kind of this presentation's evolved a bit over the past few years. It used to be that a nurse had to be the first author on a study or that a nurse had to be an author on a study. We really tried to broadly, you know, do a very broad lit search and make sure that we were capturing studies that had to do with nursing informatics and that could impact nursing. So we'll describe the corpus of publications in terms of the author country, the setting, and topic. So we searched PubMed, and for the terms of nursing informatics combined with research and interprofessional. And so the reason we put in the interprofessional is that there certainly are plenty, and it's great, of studies that cross, you know, many clinical disciplines, and we didn't want to miss out on those that perhaps didn't, maybe they didn't have a nurse author, but they were certainly important for nursing practice. And so our inclusion criteria were research that contributes to nursing informatics knowledge base, prototype development and testing, clinical care delivery focus, and informatics. So we excluded articles that focused on informatics education programs, nursing education, nursing students, and competencies. So we really wanted the focus on clinical practice. So here are our search results. So we identified 563 through our PubMed search, and 5 from the NENIC membership. So remember that for next year when the email is sent out. I'm sure there are more than 5 from everybody here in this room. And so, you know, please remember that next year and submit your articles. But, you know, great to see those come in from the membership. And we then excluded a bunch of those because they were duplicates, they were not research review, or they were related to education, nursing students, and competencies. So we were then left with 49 for our full text review. So I should have said before, records were excluded in that second bucket based on an abstract review. So the full text review of 49 articles, we excluded 33 because upon full text review, they didn't meet the criteria. And so we evaluated, we excluded 16, sorry. So we evaluated 33. So these are the journals that those 33 articles represented. What you see highlighted and listed out are informatics journals. So you can see that, you know, this literature really is across, you know, quite a number of informatics journals. Really great representation there of, you know, many of the great informatics journals. What you see, interestingly, very interestingly, in the other category, 45.5%, are essentially clinical journals. And so you can see that we're really having publications that are reaching a broad audience, you know, moving into the more clinical journal literature, which, you know, is a great thing because you want work about new innovations and development and so forth, and you know, hopefully evaluation studies showing some outcomes and impacts of informatics reaching the clinical audience so that, you know, hopefully it can have a broader impact. So countries of first authors, as expected, you know, most are from the US. We've seen that trend for a number of years now, but 27% from Australia, and then, you know, a pretty equal distribution from these other countries listed here. So the research settings and topics were continuum in public health as a setting. Expert panel, so essentially, you know, not a clinical setting here, but reaching out to various experts for their insight and opinion about a particular topic. Hospitals, long-term care, and then other. And the topics were transitions and handoffs, and we've seen that as a consistent theme over the past couple years too. Standards and terminology, human factors and usability, patient engagement, e-health surveillance, mobile health, clinical documentation, implementation, and other. So this is just the breakdown of the research settings. Absolutely, most of them based in the hospital. And then expert panel after that. So the research topics, just over 50% of them had to do with transitions and handoffs. And I think, you know, for those of you that, you know, kind of stay up with the published literature over the past few years, definitely have seen a lot of those publications for a really important topic. So human factors and usability, the next highest after that. And then about, you know, 3 to 6% for the rest of the topics. So now to highlight some of the specific publications for each topic area. And I'll go through the first half, and then Patty's going to finish that second half. So transitions and handoff. So we saw that more than 50% of the studies were about handoff. So what in a lot of really, really great research, and we highlighted some of it last year too. You know, a lot of hospitals are focused on this issue, looking at what tools they can develop, looking at what other sites have done, and seeing, you know, how they can hopefully improve the process, improve nurse satisfaction, hopefully improve patient outcomes. A lot of the studies are observational, and a lot of the studies are discussed in a way that's really site-specific. And so what we're highlighting here, not to be negative, is a Cochrane review that's actually saying, you know what, we need more rigorous handoff studies. So the work that's been done is great. A lot of it qualitative, a lot of it really informing what we should continue to do for handoff research and to implement and to understand better practices, but to really know what the best practice is and how that should be implemented and does it impact and how it impacts patient outcomes, you need more rigorous studies. So a randomized control trial or an interrupted time series where you're looking at a bunch of pre-data points, then you have an intervention and a bunch of post-data points, or a pre-post study where you actually have a control group that you can compare to. And so that's what this Cochrane review says. So they, you know, Cochrane does a lot of systematic reviews and very rigorous ones. So they have very specific criteria. And so they reviewed 2,178 citations. They identified from that 28 considered potentially relevant. And they were looking at what is the best handover style. So in terms of a specific tool being used, should handoff be at the bedside? And then I think it was the tool being used, handoff at the bedside, and there was a third, I apologize for that, a third category that they were looking at. The content that should be included, specific content within a handoff tool. And so essentially their conclusion is that we know face-to-face communication is good, structured documentation good, patient involvement, and use of health information technology to support the process. But a lot of the studies are talking about the specific tool developed at that site, and we really need studies that talk about how, you know, we here at some Boston hospitals can implement something that UCLA maybe did, and we can understand how we can generalize that, and we can look at patient outcomes too. So more rigorous studies are needed, and I think we're on the way, but that's the call to action here. So standards and terminology. So this publication is Exchanging Care Records Using HL7 V3 Care Provision Messages. So for those of you that get really excited about terminology, a new HL7 standard. And so essentially this is, you know, some people would say, well, we have the CDA. We have the clinical document architecture for continuity of care documents, and we can use that for care planning exchange of information. So this standard is essentially, it's more dynamic than just exchanging a document. So it's trying to get at how can we support referrals and this notion of there are multiple providers that are caring for a patient. And it's not just these one-time snapshots that they need, but they need, you know, a message that's sent, and then there can be a response that says, yes, I'm now responsible for this patient, I'm taking care of them. You can see who is taking care of them. You can have this dynamic sort of messaging, and it can be done for systems that are not, for, you know, hospitals and systems that are not all on the same application. And so that's what this standard is, you know, coming forward from. So HL7 has a lot of robust governance processes for voting and for moving standards through. Some say it takes a really long time, and it does because they have very set criteria for that. So this is talking about that process that they went through with a number of experts, and that this is also in collaboration with the Emerging FHIR standard. They have some collaboration, you know, coming forward with that. So more to come on that. So human factors and usability. So this study, a really interesting study, titled Nursing Focus on EMR Usability, Enhancing Documentation of Patient Outcomes. So this was from a hospital system that they had already had an EHR in place for a while, and they used the HIMSS usability checklist to optimize. And they were doing it in most of their applications and kind of in this phased approach. And so they were looking at increasing efficiency, effectiveness, and satisfaction of the nursing user interface. And the study, it does a very nice job of walking through, you know, the different types of metrics that are important. Definitely, you know, efficiency of documentation, satisfaction by the nurses, but also effectiveness. So, like, what patient outcomes can you look at? And they were talking about nursing-sensitive outcomes that you can look at. They found, now, so I think their approach and their methods and what they wanted to get at was, you know, really great in terms of all those outcomes. What's really interesting is they found 45 after they enhanced the usability based on a lot of end user design. They found 45% decrease in documentation time. They found 30% decrease in CAUTI rates, a small decrease in indwelling catheter days, documentation of the presence of pressure ulcers of stage 1 to 4, a significant decline of 43%, and then restraint utilization demonstrated 14% decrease. Now, the limitation of this article is they didn't explore, like, what are the alternative explanations for these decreases, so I found that quite interesting. You know, I like how they were looking at all these metrics, but I'm sure there's something else going on there, and, you know, I'm kind of fascinated to know, you know, where such large increases are coming from and kind of what are the dynamics around that. Obviously, they went through this whole change management and the usability of their system. But, you know, who knows what all the factors were there. So I think other studies that kind of explore some of these same, you know, same concepts would be really informative. So mobile health. So this study is feasibility and acceptability of an iPad application to explore symptom clusters in adolescents and young adults with cancer. So this was a really interesting study looking at what they call the computerized symptom capture tool. It's on an iPad application for young adults and adolescents with cancer. And so they were looking at this as an innovative approach to understand cancer patients' symptom clusters. So symptoms that, you know, occur together or group together. And from the perspective of, they called it kind of an inductive approach to, you know, allow the patients to kind of figure out and document their symptoms, and the application in some visual ways supports their clustering of that and the cancer patient's kind of description of it, and they can change how they describe it, and they can change, and, you know, exactly the information that they put into this application, and then can validate it after. It has kind of this visual graphic of the clusters of their symptoms, and they can say, yeah, that describes exactly what I'm experiencing. And then this is a tool that's seen as empowering to the patient to say to their providers, you know, these are my symptoms, as opposed to the provider just asking them a list of symptoms saying, do you have this, and this. And so they were seeing that this tool could be applied to other populations too. E-health surveillance. So this was, you know, another really interesting study titled Performance of E-Health Data Sources in Local Influenza Surveillance, a 5-year open cohort study. So this took place in Sweden. They were looking at this notion of e-health data. So one of the main things they were looking at was Google flu trends. So, you know, essentially from Google, Google flu trends aggregates data from Google search engine to estimate influenza activity. They were looking at that. They were looking at telenursing call centers. And then they were looking at hits to the local health service website visits. And then also reports by the media, so in a regional newspaper. So can you correlate influenza rates with any of this stuff going on online? And they found that they could. So they saw some correlations between you know, hits online, searches online, and then the rates that were happening, often with a delay in time, and then sometimes that delay started to decrease. So, you know, the notion is that we can get better at acting quickly on certain, you know, public health threats and those types of events. What was really interesting, though, is they found that the correlations were stronger when it was the type of influenza strain that actually hits younger folks, young and middle-aged adults, right? Because they were the ones who were actually going online and doing those searches. So it wouldn't necessarily apply to, you know, the influenza rates for the older populations. So their conclusion is kind of that, you know, these e-health data systems can absolutely work and inform us, you know, about how we can better mobilize public health resources, but you need to know the limitations and that maybe it actually is per the strand of influenza and the population that it's really targeting. So that was kind of, you know, quite an interesting finding there. And I'm going to hand this over to Patty now.
Thank you, Sarah. So to continue, we're going to start with patient engagement. And the first paper I'll talk about is a systematic review. I'm sorry, I went the wrong way. There we go. Okay, yes. Prey and colleagues from Columbia. So this is entitled Patient Engagement in the Inpatient Setting, a Systematic Review. And this is the first systematic review that looks at the use of technology to promote patient engagement. And there were, surprisingly, 17 studies that actually were done in inpatient settings where they were trying to use technology for that purpose. However, most of these studies focused on describing the technology and then reporting on satisfaction. Some of them reported a little bit on usability, but there really wasn't, as Sarah had said earlier with some of the other studies, there was no comparative effectiveness or no real rigorous evaluation of whether the systems actually made a difference with any kinds of patient outcomes. Two of the 17 did look at patient outcomes. One was smoking cessation, and another was patient satisfaction. But most of them were really a description and then usability. I think a strength. So what they found is that most of the papers where they described the technology, they had some common types of technology. And I think a strength of this paper is, sorry, I'm. Oh, where's my, okay. The slide that I thought, the graphic that I thought I put in this particular set is not here. So, but that's fine. I think the strength of the paper still exists. In this paper, if you pull it, there is a graphic which shows a model for technologies for engaging patients, and it's a triangle. And at the bottom, it has these different levels of functionality of the patient engaging technologies. And at the bottom of the triangle is entertainment. And then included in entertainment, they included email, okay? And then as you go up, the complexity of the technology gets a little bit more, or becomes more complex as you go up. So on the second level, we have generic health information. Then they say it's patient-specific information delivery, advanced communication tools. And the very top is clinical decision support for patients. And what they say is that, you know, more patients are going to be using the functionality at the bottom. And as you go up the triangle, we expect that we'll probably the use will drop off a little bit. And so we have to think about, you know, how do we design those technologies so that more people can use them? You know, we have to look at different health literacy levels and computer literacy levels. But one of their main implications of this systematic review that they point out is we need to do more evaluation studies. We need to not just describe what we're doing and looking at satisfaction, but we also need to evaluate the effectiveness. So the next topic is implementation. I think it's interesting, you know, we've been through meaningful use for the last several years, and there used to be a lot more papers on implementation. I think we had two this time. And so the one that I'm highlighting here, Sarah Collins was the first author on it. It's entitled Nursing Domain of Clinical Informatics Governance, Recommendations for Health IT Adoption and Optimization. And so here, what Sarah and her team did is they did qualitative interviews with 12 nursing informatics leaders from across the U.S. And they looked at these were all leaders from organizations that had pioneered implementing health information technology or clinical documentation systems. And then they did a qualitative analysis from these interviews, and they found that there were four themes that emerged across these sort of high-functioning organizations that spoke to what the requirements or what the infrastructure is for governance with health IT. One is that interprofessional partnerships are essential. The second is that critical role-based levels of practice and competencies need to be defined. The third was that integration into existing clinical infrastructure facilitates success. And the fourth is that clinical informatics governance is an evolving process. Now, let me see if my pop-up is here. Oh, good. Okay. So I think one of the strengths of this paper is that the authors took the time to develop a model to show you each of these findings. So this is the clinical informatics and practice, the level of practice, and the key roles. So if you look at the left-hand side, it defines what are the levels of practice, and then it defines the key roles that they found across the 12 organizations. So, and they do this for each of their findings. I think it's really quite nice, Sarah. The next category is clinical documentation. So here's another one where we used to see a lot more papers in this category. I think there was one or two. So we tried to use the same categories that we've used over the last couple of years, and we're finding that, like, some of these normally, if you only found one or two papers, you'd put it in other, right? But we're trying to use some consistency so we can kind of see trends over the years of what kinds of publications are coming up in nursing informatics. So this is a paper out of Norway. Some of you might know Cornelia Ruland. She's one of the co-authors on it. It's entitled Nurses' Experiences of Using an Interactive Tailored Patient Assessment Tool 1 year past implementation. And so this was a assessment tool that they called Choice, and they had implemented it. They did a short-term evaluation and found that, you know, had very positive feedback from the nurses about the Choice application. And then 1 year later, they went in, they did focus groups and talked to the nurses about their experiences. And what they found was that, you know, overall, the nurses still felt that this Choice tool, which allowed them to do the assessment with the patient, get the patient's perspective, and then they use that to develop the plan of care. And so they found that the nurses did view this tool as very patient-centered, and they thought that it was very good for the patient, but they made the point that it came at a price, and the price was nursing workflow. They said that, you know, there were implications for the nursing workflow when they were in a hurry, that it did take more time. They made the point that it highlighted deficiencies in nursing practice. So sometimes, you know, you implement technology, something goes wrong, and everyone blames it on the technology, but maybe it's not really the technology. We're just seeing that we need new competencies. And so with the Choice tool, they found that their communication skills were lacking. So all of a sudden, they're asking questions that they had never asked patients before, and they didn't know how to handle the patient responses. Okay, so that was one. So they needed new training to communicate with patients and really be able to effectively listen to what the responses are and integrate them into their plan of care. The other challenge, they called it ethical, new ethical challenges. And what they meant by that is this tool allowed them to get such in-depth information that they felt that there was no way they could actually address it all during a hospitalization, and they felt that there were ethical implications of that. You know, if we're going to ask for this information and we can't use it or we can't address it, you know, maybe we shouldn't be doing that. So these are some of the issues. I see people shaking their head. I think we've all done that. You know, we try to design systems to do the best thing for the patient, but we always kind of have to think about scope too. You know, what are we able to do and deliver? And that's what these nurses were saying. You know, help us design a tool so that we can do better assessment and care planning, but that it's feasible to actually do the work in the context of the time that we have with the patient. So then under the other category, we have a paper called The Impact of Clinical Leadership on Health Information Technology Adoption, a Systematic Review. And so here they were looking at, this is a team from Australia that was looking at associations between clinical leadership and successful IT adoption. So I think all of us who have gone through any kind of implementation know that leadership makes a difference. And so with this systematic review, they found that there were certain characteristics of leaders. So this was their 32 papers met their criteria, and there were certain proactive leadership behaviors and partnerships that they saw really made a difference for successful implementations. And those were that the leaders had prior experience with health IT project management management. I don't think that's a surprise. We know that health IT projects are complex. They're difficult. You get better at that the more you do. So that one's not a surprise. A vision that comprises long-term commitment to the use of IT is essential, right? It's not all about, you know, what we're implementing now, but it's the vision. You know, what are the suite of tools and the workflow processes that we're going to be implementing over time to improve patient care and to support practice? A belief in the value of IT so that this technology can really make a difference. It can really help us to provide better care. And then motivated to adopt health IT, so really seeing it again as a tool. And then lastly, the ability able to maintain confidence and stability through the adversity. So I think that's a good, that's something that, you know, at Brigham, we're going live at the end of the month or the end of next month, starting tomorrow. And I think all of the leaders who are in this room, this is a good message that when things get tough, and they will probably in the first or second day, that, you know, staying confident, know that there's been a lot of work that's gone into this, and there's going to be a lot of people in the very beginning who maybe won't be that pleasant when they're caught up in their workflow. And but stay confident because it'll work out in the end. The other thing that they did in this paper that I really liked is they mapped the results to Basilier's Information Technology Competence of Business Managers framework. And what they found was that their findings actually fit really well into this framework. So it was another way of validating that these findings were actually quite good. Okay, so we added this other category, and there's two papers that we put in the bibliography, other important informatics papers that did not meet the criteria. So, you know, Sarah said we the first year we did this, the nurse had to be a first author in order for them to be included. And then last year we said, well, they just had to have at least one author that was a nurse. And then this year we said, well, we missed a couple good papers last year, so you don't have to be a nurse. It doesn't have to be a nurse author, as Sarah mentioned, but they do have to. It does have to address informatics, nursing informatics. So this was a paper that the first author is Shoba Fansalker. So she is now with, she used to be at the Brigham in our team. She's done a lot of work looking at clinical decision support, and this paper was called Evaluation of Medication Alerts in Electronic Health Records for Compliance with Human Factor Principles. Okay, and so what they did was they used a tool called the iMedessa Usability Questionnaire. So this was a questionnaire that team had developed through a previous study. And then they assessed compliance with 9 human factor principles of drug-drug interaction alerts. And they looked at 14 different EHRs and 14 different health systems. Some of them were vendor systems, some of them were homegrown systems. And they found that there really wasn't, you know, homegrown wasn't better, vendor wasn't better. They were both sort of all over the map in terms of how well they did with usability. But they found some common weaknesses across the systems. One was the absence of alert prioritization. So giving alerts and there is no, so I know at Partners we have tiered alerts, right? So at least we do now. I don't know if we're gonna have them next week. Or so, not causing hard stops for an alert that, you know, maybe would be okay just to skip by. Because I don't know if all of you know this, when I first started reading about decision support and the override rate in many healthcare systems is about 90 or 95%. It's very, very high. I mean, in our healthcare system, I think it's 75%, and that's supposed to be good. So, you know, we override way too many of these. So, you know, work looking at, you know, how do we make this clinical decision support better is really important. Second is clear and concise alert messages indicating the interacting drugs. So not just saying there's interaction, but letting them know, you know, what is the drug that it's interacting with? Actions for clinical management. So, all right, there's an interaction. What do I do? What are the suggestions? And then a statement indicating the consequences of overriding. Okay, so really giving the prescriber more information about consequences so that they can make better decisions. I put in here an example of, this is an alert that scored highly on the construct of placement. So it shows the user the type of interaction. It allowed the user to enter in the response to the alert. It links the alert to the medication order. So it's an actionable alert. The user can actually go in and fix it. We included this paper because we saw really nothing about nursing clinical decision support. We need more nursing clinical decision support in our electronic systems. And when we get it in there, we need methods of evaluating how good it is, all right? So I want people to be aware of this iMedessa tool. Sarah also highlighted a tool from another paper. But thinking about, you know, when you do implement nursing clinical decision support, you know, then we think about optimization, all right? So how's it working, and how well is this serving the nurses who need to use it? So just to summarize, we did look at the publications, the research publications from the spring of last year through the end of February of this year. We found that the nursing informatics research was published in a wide variety of topics in informatics, nursing, and healthcare journals. And I think one of the biggest changes we saw over the past couple of years is that instead of the informatics papers being mostly in informatics journals, half of them are. Okay, and they're spread out across a lot of different journals, and half of them are in clinical journals. So we see that as good. We're penetrating, we're getting out there more. The most common research topic was transitions and handoffs, so about half of the papers were on that topic. We saw many fewer studies published on implementation, CPOE, BICMA, EMAR. And, you know, I think we're several years into meaningful use. I think most people have implemented or, you know, are about to implement soon. And so we've stopped writing about that. and we are starting to write about other things, okay? So handoff, I think that that's a really important topic, but I think now that we are all implementing or have implemented our electronic health record systems and our nursing systems, we need to start to study the effectiveness. Okay, so we found a couple significant gaps. So last year I highlighted a paper that Dawn Dowding had written on international research priorities for nursing informatics. And the top four priorities related to clinical decision support for nurses and then rigorous evaluation. And again, you know, these are huge gaps in the literature. We really didn't see any papers that, that researched clinical decision support for nursing or did any kind of rigorous evaluation on systems that nurses are using. We also saw some methods gaps. So again, comparative effectiveness, if we're going to evaluate, we need to be able to, if we're looking at, 27 different types of handoff, which ones are most effective. We need to start to study that. We also saw some measurement gaps. So, relevant patient-reported outcomes, so those are still relatively rare in the literature. And then also metrics to support generalizability. So, we still see a lot of studies where we're looking at satisfaction. We're starting to see more looking at some usability. But, recently we were funded, we have a patient safety learning lab now at Brigham and Women's Hospital, and we've adopted the REAIM framework. And REAIM, I've listed out here, reach, efficiency, adoption, implementation, and maintenance. And what we did is we framed all of our research questions for the different projects that we're doing within the patient safety learning lab to measure reach. Okay, so what percentage of the population that we were trying to reach did we actually reach? How many people actually used it? Efficiency, what was the impact of our intervention on workflow? Okay, and we have specific, for each of the measures in these categories, we have specific operational definitions and we're capturing them in the context of our research. Adoption, so, is this intervention being used as designed? Is it being used in the context of the clinical care? Implementation, how did the implementation go? Were there changes that needed to be made and what kinds of refinements? And then maintenance, so how well does it work over time? So for example, that study I think that Cornelia Ruland's group did looking at their choice application a year later. So they had very good results right after they implemented it. But then once time goes by, are people still using it? Is it being used as intended? And are we still reaching the population that we want to reach? So that concludes the formal presentation of the different studies that we looked at. We have in the back of the slides, which are available on the web, the whole bibliography. So you have that for reference in case there's anything that you're interested in and that you'd like to look up. But what we thought we'd do is leave a few minutes for your questions, and then we also have some discussion questions. I think one of the main points that Sarah and I both talked about that we think is a great opportunity for this group is now most of our organizations have implemented electronic records. And this is new, right? So 5 years ago, this conference has been going on for 13 years, right? 5 years ago or 4 years ago, that was not true. There were still, we're all in different places. But now, many of us either have implemented or are implementing this year, and many of us have the same vendor system. And so, there is a lot of opportunity for cross-organizational research, looking at the effectiveness of the systems, using that REAIM framework to really measure what is it that we're doing, what's working well. Clinical decision support. So I don't think we have a lot of clinical decision support for nursing in our phase one version of EPIC. And I see people who know the answer saying, no, we don't. that's going to be an important place for optimization, right? And if many of us have the same system, many of us have the same version because we're implementing very close. And so here's an opportunity where we could potentially implement nursing clinical decision support and look at how effective it is over organizations. So those are just a couple thoughts, and I'll stop there and we'll take your questions, and then if we have time we can also go through some of the discussion questions we've come up with. Any questions? All right, first of all, go ahead.
I have a question. I have recently said Partners Need Care, and I trained on ambulatory and a provider applications. And I know secondly there's a research application. I was just curious, and good luck to you. I know Go Live is over. But I was curious, is this a great, a prime time now, June, July, just once the staff nurses learn, Clinton Knox will be their application. My question is, where do nurses now go if they want to see some of the great research that's being done at Brigham's and Mass General and all within Partners? And will it change now that we have EPIC? I'm not sure if that's affecting informatics, but research specifically that's being done in-house.
So is your question, do you understand? Are you asking if the nurses at the Brigham where they would go to see, or do you think in general?
You've mentioned first part of the presentation that you'd like to see more the staff nurses get involved, do more concrete type of quantitative, research. But if they want to see too much going on now for research, do they go to the nursing, outside of EPIC, they go to, or LMI, this is what's there now, they go outside of those systems department to see what's going on, and if anyone's sort of interested in doing research on implementation and then optimization, things that the things are going to be rolling out soon.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think your question is, so if nurses who are working on the clinical units are interested in getting involved in research projects, what would the process be? So at the Brigham, we have a Center for Nursing Excellence. We do provide several programs over the course of the year on conducting research as a nurse, and through that, we help nurses develop their ideas, or if they would just like to be involved, we try to connect them with a project. So, for example, right now we're doing this Patient Safety Learning Labs project. So, through teaching that class a couple weeks ago, I met a nurse who's really interested in fall prevention, and she wants to get involved in our project. She wants to help with the pilot. She was able to pull together a group of champions to work with us. So, It's a match made in heaven from my perspective, because for these research projects, we're finally at the point where I think we're getting good at knowing that unless you have enough involvement with the clinical people at the bedside, it's not going to work. It's just like an implementation, right? You really have to get really well connected, and so I think finding clinical champions that are interested in research and really believe in the project, it really can make a difference on the ground. So that's kind of how we do it. But it's probably different. Maybe people have other ideas. So Sarah's at Partners. So what would you say for Partners?
Well, I'd just say that essentially the forming the collaboration and relationships with other people interested in this in the same or similar problems is, I think, key, especially as Most of the systems, especially in any large health system, are now enterprise EHR systems. And so, if you are going to try to implement and study something, you have to consider, what's the feasibility of studying it on one unit versus now we have enterprise EHRs and we have to look at, what's the enterprise build for that, and how can you have a pilot, but how can you also be within the governance structure of an enterprise built for the EHR. So forming the relationships with people, I think, who on clinical units are interested is probably very key, as well as folks involved with what your EHR project is.
Other questions? this is the one that this is a presentation that you don't prepare and then just keep doing it again and again and again. Well, I'll tell you, you know, the topic of nursing terminology standards, that used to be one of the largest topics for research. We used to find a lot of, just a couple years ago, there were many, many, that was one of the larger categories. There were two papers, right? So people aren't even looking at it. So maybe, Sarah, do you want to talk about the standardized terminology for e-care?
Sure. You know, I think that you have to kind of reflect on how large some, you know, EHR configuration projects are and how important it is to, you know, remember to map to standards when you're configuring those systems and you're defining, you know, various data elements and the build that, I mean, it's enterprise-wide, it's huge, you know, and so it's not just nursing, it's getting the standards mapped in there that absolutely include nursing data elements, nursing sensitive outcomes. I think that, you know, we're learning. It takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of governance. And then consideration of what other people are doing in the project as well, and, you know, people's timeline and resources. And so, you know, there's a lot of optimization, probably, optimization work in terms of, you know, getting the data definitions right and, you know, knowing how to kind of maintain those. You know, I'll say that some of our work in clinical informatics, we've had great discussions with, like, Kaiser about, you know, how have they done this for so long and learning from them. So really learning from, you know, and we've done this at partners for a long time too, but it's different when you then are using a new system and you have to kind of, you know, make sure the processes are in place. And so, you know, collaboration with other sites and how they're able to do it as well. But, I mean, most basically, mapping to SNOMED.
Yeah. And so, I mean, the thing is with SNOMED, though, so it is a standard, right? Yeah. And for, I think one of the limitations with, I know, the vendor system we have is that you can't have multiple levels of terminology.
Yeah.
Now, fortunately, all of the nursing terminologies are mapped within SNOMED.
Yeah.
So we can use subsets like the CCC subset, or if you were using ICMP and you want to use those, there's different, but this is going to have to be the optimization phase. So in the general go live, the unfortunately, there's a ton of work that has to be done in a very tight period of time. So the important thing is you do map to a standardized terminology. You take one that, like SNOMED, that's very inclusive, then you can start looking at, all right, how do we make subsets so this can really help our workflow and make it work? And that's probably where we need to go next.
Yeah. And I'll add that, you know, we're finding some success in doing this, focusing on particular clinical topics that, you know, I think certainly apply to nursing, but you shouldn't just look at, you know, nursing. So if you're looking at, we had a poster, pain. Right, so there are other disciplines that document about pain. We want to make sure that that's consistent across. And so perhaps looking at focused topics is an avenue to do that. And then you can scope it, and you can make sure you get it right and get the, you know, the clinical expertise that you need in there. And then topics that cut across your system are useful in that way, because a build can happen, you know, in isolation for particular settings, and you can get it right in different clinical settings, but you want that cross, you know, the data definitions that cross and can be mapped well, and so then that your reporting on the other end and decision support isn't just specific to one setting, that you can see outcomes across those settings.
That's a perfect segue to my question. So, I, you know, good design is always informed by research, or hopefully is informed by research. And I think, you know, we've noticed that there are a lot of major implementations going on in the New England area. And is there a role for NENIC in helping to look at tools or ways that the design can be evaluated, you know, and sharing best practices? And I'd just like your comments and reflections on that.
Well, before we can evaluate design, we have to have studies. So maybe there's a role for NENIC in organizing a study that we can then evaluate the design.
Sounds good.
Because we're just not doing the studies. I mean, that's the problem, right? We're not doing the evaluation studies. So I think it would be great if, you know, one role of NENIC was to try to bring together a think tank of, okay, what can we evaluate? So now that everybody has a certain vendor system implemented in their hospital, what is one thing that we can measure across all the hospitals? And one small thing and start there. That would be a great role for NENIC.
How did you, Patty, that's the thing, you know, you can envision a NENIC Research Institute, right? That not every organization has the luxury of having a dedicated nurse scientist function within it. But perhaps NENIC as an institution takes on the role of helping to form what research might look like, what the methods might look like, the approach, et cetera. And maybe that's what we do.
And setting up the processes so that the teams at the hospitals know, oh, okay, this is what we have to do. And it's because research can become very overwhelming if you don't understand all the steps, right, until you get into it. And that's really, I think, what we can help with.
Hi, Patty.
Hi, Tiffany.
That was a nice segue into my question. So I completely agree with the comparative effectiveness research, and that I see that as a population level management, but there's also the patient level evaluation of, in real time, how nurses are using the systems. Mm-hmm. Trying to tackle both at the same time and then being able to implement those change in a effective way. Mm-hmm. What do you see as recommendations to how to conduct the studies and then rapidly implement those changes?
So I think that, you know, the re-aim is actually quite good for that. I don't know if there's a paper, you know, what we can do is maybe the re-aim framework that, there's a paper that Sue Bakken and Cornelia Ruland, I think, wrote on using the re-aim for informatics projects. And they give a whole, they have a table where they have the re-aim and then they have sample research questions. And I think that that's one way you can do it because it does look at from every single angle. First of all, how do you design? Mm-hmm. And then how do you get feedback around that? How do you implement it? How do you evaluate that implementation? How do you make sure that, you know, there's got to be a dose. Like if no one's using your intervention, it kind of reminds me of the study you talked about where we saw these huge, they changed the documentation system and saw huge decreases in falls and pressure. Yeah. You know, I think, well, what else did they do, right? Like there has to be a dose. Like so what we need, the thing that's missing is we don't know how often did they use whatever this thing was. Yeah. And what was the dose? So it's hard to evaluate what the impact of your system is unless you're collecting data to know what all the different factors were.
Right. And to get to a comparative effectiveness study, you have to have gone through the steps of user-centered design, you know, and part of that is definitely, you know, qualitative research around that. Mm-hmm. And then you get to a point where, okay, you know, we have a design and a system and it meets certain satisfaction metrics as well. And then you can do a rigorous comparative effectiveness design, but you wouldn't be implementing something like that right at the beginning if you're unsure of, you know, exactly how it should have looked. But once you think, okay, we think we got it right, let's see if this has an impact.
Okay. Thank you.
Rita.
So another very important parameter to that is how these different institutions have mapped their terminologies. Because if you're going to look at effects on pain, is everyone defining pain and the parameters?
Did everyone use the same subset in SNOMED?
We would love to do that work.
So it's great to have a terminologist in the audience. I was thinking of you, Rita, when I saw there was like one or two terminology papers. Like, oh.
It
seems
to me like the problem is solved.
Yep, SNOMED. Any other questions? Did we miss any papers? How many of you published a research paper in the last year, but you didn't send it to us? Anybody? Okay, so we'll have to get started on that, Mary. We have the charge for NENIC.